Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to people that aren't from Ashfield, welcome to Ashfield. I am Doug Hill, the chairman of the council agency here at Ashfield. And I have to do some, I guess, information. Hopefully that nothing ever happens, but we do need to get out of here in a hurry. There's two fire escapes. If you see the doors on the side of it, the stage that goes straight down to the outside. And be very careful because those stairs are very steep. Restrooms are all the way down to the main floor, then around again and down to the basement by the police station. That gives it that way, and the exit signs are all up. And I would like to introduce our council of aging here in Ashfield that started all this, and then everybody else has picked it up. First of all, I'm really and you're in way back. Nina Loring, right here. We have one of the gentlemen, two of the gentlemen. Wayne Wickland, who was recovering from surgery. He had surgery Tuesday, so he's recovering. And our other gentleman is Steve Sambalski, and he and his wife are in Florida helping her father out. I'm not sure whether he was involved in the hurricane down there or not, but they had to go to Florida to help him. Great, welcome. And now I'm going to turn it over to Buzz and Adam and Christine
and everybody.
And everybody.
Hi, good evening. My name is Buzz Eisenberg, and I have the pleasure of moderating this tonight. The Council on Aging, again, thank you to the Ashfield Council on Aging, is co-sponsoring this debate along with the Shelter Falls Senior Center, at Shelter Falls, the Recorder, the Daily Hampshire Gazette, the Northampton Area League of Women Voters, who do such a great job assisting in these forums. WHMP and Falls Cable TV, which will be taping this tonight. We can't live stream because we don't have enough bandwidth here. senatorial candidates in Ashfield. We'll be taping it. It will be on Falls Cable. And thank you, Otis Wheeler, for taping this. And he will be providing that CD to other public access stations that request it. This can also, you can watch it on the Recorder's webpage and the Daily Hampshire Gazette's webpage. You can stream it on those sites as well. Particular thanks, and seated at the table is Jean Sherdak of the Northampton League of Women Voters. Jean and her colleagues will be vetting and reading audience questions, which you provide to ask the candidates. I think, is it going to be Chris Flory at the League who's going to gather those questions? We'll ferry them up to you. And then, Gene, for every one question that each of the other panelists get, two of your questions will be asked by Gene. So I think it's a great format that the committee came up with. Our candidates, of course, are Christine Canning, Chris, as much as you know that, and Adam Hines. I'd like to thank them very much for coming out to Ashfield tonight. Our media panel is Kathy Bunton, the director of the Senior Center, which serves Shelburne Falls, Bunton, and Ashfield. I'm sorry, they changed the name in the last year, and I'm still used to Shelburne Falls Senior Center. Diane Brocaccio of the Recorder, hi Diane. Stephanie Slish of WHMP, and again, Jean. Timing, and I will talk about timing in a minute, will be Margie Riddle, who's seated. Did you raise your hand, Margie? Thank you so much. And Laura Dentino, the wonderful events coordinator for the Gazette and the Recorder, who always has such an important role to play in this. The format which we're going to follow is there will be, once I've introduced our candidates, we will then begin and we'll go in the order in which our panelists are seated, and we will ask a question. The person to whom a question is asked will have 3 minutes respond. Hopefully that's enough time for us to get a good sense of the answer, and then there will be 1 minute provided for rebuttal. The candidates, of course, can choose to do less than that if they're going to go a little over. We obviously will be forgiving. We're here to hear them. And so that's how we're going to do this. I just want to remind both the panelists, there are microphones at each station here. Because of our very sophisticated sound system here in Ashfield,
if one of our thumbs knocks that on button to off, all of them go dead.
So handle it with great care and put it close to your mouth. I'm told to treat it like an ice cream cone, but don't lick. So, in alphabetical order, brief bio of each of our candidates. First, Chris Canning, a Republican, is completing her fifth university degree, a doctorate in educational policy. Canning is a licensed superintendent of schools who holds 4 professional teaching licenses. She owns an SDO certified corporation and an LLC, which have held contracts at the state and the federal level. In 2010, Chris worked with Senator Downing to change a procurement law that saved the Commonwealth millions of dollars. Canning has been a successful whistleblower in Superior Court and in Massachusetts Commission Against Discrimination suits involving fraud, discrimination, and protecting the health, welfare, and safety of children. The GOP candidate worked for the UAE Presidential Court, as well as, I assume that's the United Arab Emirates Presidential Court, as well as holding contracts to train the former KGB, DCA, militaries, and ministries worldwide in such places as Tunisia, Ukraine, Estonia, Kosovo, Algeria, UAE, Kuwait, Oman, Bahrain, Paraguay, South Korea, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, and Cyprus. Is there any oxygen in that? She's been the recipient of a Fulbright-Hays grant. Further, Canning has held contracts with the Department of State, American embassies around the world, INL, and published with giants such as McGraw-Hill. Under His Excellency Sheikh Nayahan, Canning chaired a 13-country delegation for Tessel Arabia 2000 and was selected by her peers in 2010 to run the World Conference with 3 peers for Tessel International. Canning has been an ordinary member of the NAACP, been elected to the board of MATSOL, and appointed 2 terms by the Commissioner of Education to serve on the RIAC board. Canning has published in numerous referee journals and has been the keynote at many worldwide conferences in Russia, Egypt, UK, South Korea, Middle East, and former Soviet republics. If you would hold your applause until I introduce our other candidates, and then I would join you in applauding them both and again thanking them for being here. Adam Hines grew up in the state Senate district town of Buckland, where I think we know where that is, where he attended Mohawk Trail Regional High School, where his parents both worked. Hines attended Wesleyan University and attended the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy at Tufts University. Hines served as U.S. Congressman John Oliver's campaign manager and worked on then United States Senator Kerry's presidential campaign. Adam spent 10 years working at the United Nations, often in the Middle East, before returning to the district to help the Pittsfield Community Connection, a program that proactively engages at-risk youth. Today, Hines serves as the executive director of the Northern Berkshire Community Coalition, an organization empowering area residents who face challenges related to employment, healthcare, and addiction, and you would join me in thanking them for being here tonight. So, first question will be from Kathy Bunsen, and again, 3 minutes to answer, 1 minute for rebuttal.
We're on?
Should be on.
Yes, can you hear me?
Like an ice cream cone. I'm sorry for the confusion. I was not aware of the opening statements, but do you wish to give an opening statement, each of you?
Sure. You want me to go? first, Mr. Hunter?
Yes, sure, Mr. Hunter.
All right, great. Well, it's great to be here. Thank you to everyone who's come out, and thank you, Buzz, for moderating, and who do we have here now? Council on Aging, and Gazette and Recorder, and WHMP, and others, and thanks to False Cable for filming. What's great about being here is it's not only that I grew up in the next town over, but I consider myself to continue to be a member of the community, including by trying to get as regularly as possible to Ashfield Taekwondo, and Nassau Lynch is here. And as you heard from my bio, I try to capture my background as basically bringing large groups of people together to take on the big challenges, and often by creating a common vision for the future. It's not the most conventional background for running for state senate, but it is one that has prepared me to stand up to Beacon Hill. And when we go through all the issues, I'm sure we will tonight, about what the challenges we face, it's actually the case that we are treated differently out here in Western Mass. So whether it's high-speed internet, whether it's school funding and how we're impacted in rural schools or supporting small towns, there is a difference. And we do need someone who can stand up and be a strong voice for Western Mass, and maybe be the convener locally as necessary. The other thing that my background has convinced me of is that we can't tackle those challenges unless we do it together. And I'm gonna dwell on that a bit tonight, because in the context of the national political environment, we can do politics differently here. In fact, we have to. And so one of the common themes of my campaign is going to be, how are we going to be a positive force for undertaking our challenges? How are we going to do it in an inclusive way? How are we going to do it in a way that is essentially disregarding the old politics of attack and attack and attack and negativity? And so I look forward to taking that on as a candidate and as a state senator, because that's how we're going to make progress on the challenges and the priorities that we have here. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Adams. Chris.
Poor Adam's going to sit through this again, but it's true. Man dies, he goes to heaven, and basically when he gets up there, he says to God, you know, I don't think I know if this is the right place for me. So God says, go on down. So down he goes to hell, and he sees the dancing girls, and he marches himself back up to heaven and says, well, you know what? I think it's a better match for me. God said, look it, I'm not anyone who's going to tell you what to do. So he went back to hell, and he went down, and he met the devil. And the devil said to him, what do you think? He goes, this isn't what you showed me yesterday. The devil put his arm around him and said, yesterday I was recruiting, today you're staff. And when you look at something like that, it's the same with politicians. What you see isn't always what you get. My father's a left-wing Democrat, my mother's a right-wing Republican, and I happen to be the byproduct, okay? So you're gonna find that some of my answers and Adam's answers aren't gonna match. And I think on social issues, they do. As a Republican, I'm financially and fiscally fit. I see how school districts are taxing towns. I also will address different issues that are loopholes in our system that lead to nepotism, corruption, fraud. And that's why when I did see one thing in our procurement process, I was able to go to bed down and we worked to change a law. And why we changed the law, it ended up saving us millions of dollars because Massachusetts companies finally got preference. You would have thought many things were happening, but they weren't. I've also been the whistleblower, as I said, on different suits that have benefited the health, welfare, and safety of children and have exposed tax fraud. So if I am your next senator, know that I'm a doer. I go 110%, and I'm someone, in general, that you will find that is very approachable, and I'm open-minded to many different people's ideas. Thank you so much, and have a wonderful evening with us tonight.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Adam. Now, Kathy Bunce.
Thank you. I'll ask both of you, and then you would each answer the same question.
I think the format is you ask one of them, and the other will have a minute rebuttal.
Okay. So, Adam, currently, the Executive Office of Elder Affairs budget is based on a $10 per elder budget. That per elder number comes from the 2010 census. According to the University of Massachusetts Donahue Institute, since 2010, another 220,000 Massachusetts citizens have turned 60 years of age, stretching those dollars even further. If the budget is being reviewed or cuts considered, how will you stand on supporting the Elder Affairs budget?
You're putting your finger, thanks for that question, it's an important one, because you're putting your finger on the dynamic of the demographics throughout this district and throughout Western Mass, which is namely that we're growing older as a population, and so in Franklin County, about a quarter of the population will be over 60 years old. I know in Berkshire County, by 2030, 60% of the population is gonna be over 60. It's a big issue for this district. It's a bit of a no-brainer. Of course, we need to stand up and make sure that the proper services for our elders are protected. When you're looking at a rural area, there are a number of priorities that come to mind. And one is, what are we doing about housing? And there are some great examples that Dave Christopoulos in Chesterfield, but based in the Goshen area, ensuring that there's affordable housing for seniors right downtown and successful. I love that model. It's one that I would love to pursue elsewhere. Making sure folks can stay in their homes longer. So that means, particularly in the rural area, what are we doing about transportation for medical appointments or for shopping? And so there's a range of issues that are unique here, and making sure that we're getting that right. I'm not sure if I should talk about it now, but maybe later in healthcare, prescription drug costs and on and on. There's a number of issues that we need to be standing up for as legislators. Maybe I'll leave it there, but it's on the top of my list, and we talk about it just about every room I go into.
1 minute, Chris.
When it comes to elder affairs, I also have other thoughts. I really think there's a lot of problems with the Massachusetts state budget. I think there's a lot of waste, and I think the money needs to go back to the elderly. Currently, right now, 80% of elderly are living with their families. But we also have elderly that are in the gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender population who don't have families. We also have to look at people's fears of intimidation as they grow older. We have to look at Medicare and different costs. And I've talked to people, even my own parents, of what it's costing them in premiums. And when you retire, part of your salary goes away. So $10, when I hear that, to me, is disgusting. And personally, I'll find money, and I don't care if I have to cut in other areas, because I do see a lot of waste in the budgets, and right now, we can't move state budgets. And with 30 seconds, I promise I'll end there.
Thank you. Diane Brancaccio of the Recorder.
Okay, this question goes to Chris. How do you feel about ballot question two, to raise the cap on charter schools? And if the ballot question is approved by voters, what could the legislature do to approve new charter schools in a way that doesn't hurt rural school districts?
This is a really good question. I'm a licensed superintendent, so this is where I'm going to hit you from. The question with ballot two should never be coming out right now. And the reason is, they have not prepared this correctly. As it currently stands, a charter school can take a student and the money from the public school and municipalities, and if the student doesn't last more than a month, send them back, but the money doesn't follow. Now, we need a prorated system. Further, charter schools can also choose, in some instances, which children they take, and I've worked with three different cases when I had children with mental health issues that were kind of pushed out in indirect ways. That has to stop, and there has to be more accountability from the Department of Elementary and Secondary Ed. However, in our end of the state, question two probably is not a good idea, as many of our teachers are public school teachers, and they're doing a fabulous job. Where is it a problem? I've taught in Springfield and Holyoke, and as on the riot board, I've been into some Boston schools. Lawrence and Taunton, those areas do need charter schools. Now, what this ballot question is saying, that up to 12 schools can be opened. Does that mean all 12 will be opened? No. And what it means is there's the possibility of. So right now, the way I'm telling people, the way it's worded prematurely, is if you're voting yes for question two, you're pro-children in the eastern end of the state. Yes, we have some level three districts out in our end of the state, but they are not level four and they are not level five. And if you don't understand what level four and five means, I taught in one of them. I had seniors who had to read into a machine that said, cat. Why? Because the school district was protecting themselves to make sure they weren't sued. Because with a free and appropriate education, they could prove the kid could read. How much he could read is another whole story. So that's why you need someone in there who really knows, the two joint education committees, what you're looking at. And also, so you know, I was the whistleblower on Holyoke, and that's one of the reasons the state took over. When I realized what was happening, I reported everything. Okay, so personally, that's where I stand on question two. I myself am divided, but I wish it would be more clear, because as it stands now, you could really bankrupt the town by sending kids here or there with BART. But BART has number one scores, but BART gets to choose who they want, and they can unchoose who they want. So there's not equity. And 30 seconds, I'm done.
Adam, 1 minute.
I'm opposed to lifting the cap on charter schools, and to me, it's really about financing. We know right here in Mohawk, for example, there's a Chapter 70 shortfall of over $600,000. And so it's really about, we need to get our financing right first. And so we see too much money leaving public schools, and so that's my priority. If it were to pass, by the way, I should mention, you know, my father was a public school teacher. We've talked about this at length. I've been endorsed by the Massachusetts Teachers Association and the American Federation of Teachers, and it's because I've prioritized getting the funding right throughout this campaign. I hope we talk about education further, because that's just one piece of the problem when it comes to funding our schools here. And I really want to get behind Superintendent Bunnicani and what he's doing to build a coalition of rural schools. But I'll pause on that until later. If it were to pass, the State Senate this year passed the RISE Act. It didn't go further than that, but the idea was to do just that. How do you make sure that it's targeting certain districts that have a number of at-risk kids and the like? And so I would be interested in trying to dissect that piece of the legislation further.
Thank you. Stephanie Slish, WHMP.
Thank you. With an aging population in rural Western Mass, what policies do you support to encourage millennials and young families to invest in this district?
Both of you, two out of the three questions have hit this dynamic of what we're addressing here when it comes to our demographics. There's a bit of a camel's hump when you look at our population, and the low point is those 20 and 30 year olds, the millennials. And Franklin and Berkshire County are two out of the three counties in the entire state that have experienced population loss. And you don't have to think too long to understand what that means on our tax base and our budgets, let alone our economic development and down the line. To me, there's a few things that we need to do. One is getting our basic infrastructure right. It's very hard to make the argument to a young family or a young entrepreneur that they should move to this area if we don't have high-speed internet. We can come back to that, because there has been progress even since this campaign started. But getting some of that basic infrastructure right, I would argue in other parts of the district also, you know, high-speed trains in east-west or north-south, so that we can go to those guys, those millennials in Boston or Brooklyn and say, look, you can do that job out here, and meanwhile, by the way, you have a tremendous quality of life. That's part of the reason I chose to come back here. Guess what? I can be near family, do good work, mountain bike, ski, and enjoy world-class cultural institutions. It's fantastic, and it's part of the brand that we do need to get out there. Those are just some of the pieces. I highlighted earlier this week, actually, a company called Zogix, and it was deliberately for the purpose of making this point that you're making. It's this gentleman from Boston who chose to live in Lenox, Massachusetts, because he could, with the business ecosystem what it is today, anywhere there's communication and transportation, he could do his work. And he literally developed a product, essentially it's eco-friendly gym wipes, among other things, and sends it throughout the world. And he can do it based anywhere. And so we need to be able to at least point to that infrastructure to say, if you can do your job anywhere, you can be an entrepreneur anywhere, do it here. And this ties in, by the way, to everything we've been talking about around education and the like. If you're somebody, in this case, he was in the early 40s, and even though he started the business in his 30s, we have to be able to say to him, guess what, and your kids are going to go to the best schools around as well. And so if there isn't a silver bullet for addressing population decline, and so those are some of the elements I would pursue.
Chris.
To attract millennials here, I've actually gone out and asked as a business owner, and I think the thing I put in the trade and commerce article I did was that we need to think of our area when explaining it to them like the letter L, except flip this way, so that you realize we're the 90-degree angle and the potential that we have between Boston and New York City. We have to look about bringing the train system up. We also have to look about extending the Mass Pike in our interstates, because right now a lot of trucks and different things are having higher costs trying to come into the small towns. There are other things we need to look at. First of all, we need to repurpose our infrastructure so that people want to come. And I think that's the first thing. And for millennials, just so you know, when my husband died, I brought both of my children back to be raised here because it's a good place to live.
Thank you. So, Gene Chernock of the Northampton Area League of Winter. Could you pick up your nameplate so they all know who you are? There we are. Of the Northampton Area League of Women Voters. Gene will be asking two of your questions, audience questions. I think this one is to Chris, correct? And I just want to make one other comment. When you use a microphone, it not only amplifies, but it records. So make sure that it's close to your mouth. We don't have to, yeah, that's it. Thanks. Gene.
Okay, Chris, this is a two-part question, actually. Please discuss your stance on the Second Amendment and A.G. Healy's new interpretation of laws that had been in place since 1994. How would you plan on dealing with the unilateral overreach of her office?
Oh, you've just given me the golden ticket. I just got the number one marks from anyone running from the NRA, and I'm a goal member. Matter of fact, I just got my 15-year-old daughter her FID license. I am a constitutionalist to heart. The Second Amendment, I know originally, was to build up so we had guns for a militia, but in 2008, as we know with Scalia, SCOTUS, or the Supreme Court, gave us the right to own guns. Does that mean you should have a gun? No. But there are some things that Maura Healey has done that are wrong, and Healey has hurt families. There are people who need to hunt. They make it sound like we have all these gun-crazy people. To be honest with you, Massachusetts has the most stringent laws. My favorite line is she's against assault rifles. Please go to the dictionary. There's no such thing as an assault rifle. There are different guns that exist. And it depends on who you give it to. Now, if you look at the question on the exam that the police give you to get your license, one of them says, have you been committed? Well, what does that mean? Does it mean, have you committed yourself voluntarily? Or the ambiguity, has the state committed you? Or what if you were a vet and you come back and you've had services? We have a lot of checks, but we have a lot of loopholes. And here's a great example. If you're a felon, let's say you committed a felony at 18, you come back to Massachusetts, you're 60 and want to go hunting your deer, you can't. But a felon from Vermont can come over the border and shoot. Last year alone, 77,000 people lied on their gun papers and were rejected. Only 330 had perjury charges brought against them, and only 13 cases were ever convicted. We have real problems with guns, like gun shows. These are real issues. The issue that Maura Healey brought was overstepping her reach, and actually right now, Glock and Remington have left. We've lost the commerce and the jobs, and I don't think the police and law enforcement are gonna like it since Glock makes their weapons. So these are things that you have to take into consideration. And although I am a goal member, and I was their number one choice with the NRA, I don't have a gun in my house. That's a personal choice, but it's my constitutional right if I wish to have one. So that's where I stand on it. And I most recently gave a talk too, because what people don't understand is, Maura Healey said, if it looks like or resembles. So I opened a thing and brought out a plastic bunny. I said, it looks like a bunny, but does it really hop? No. So she really needs to know what the parts are and not make a unilateral decision. That had to go through the legislature. She bypassed it. And that's why Congress right now has given her a subpoena to come, and she's blown off Congress. So I think Congress will have to take care of her.
Adam, 1 minute.
Look, growing up around here, you have a lot of friends who hunt, and I support the right to have an arm. I support have weapons. I spent a lot of time in Iraq, surrounded by armed bodyguards and assault rifles, and I was pretty darn glad they were there a lot of times. But that's the difference, is that the weapons that we're talking about were intended to be weapons of war. And so being clear about what we want on our streets and not is important, and it should be a deliberate conversation. So could Maura Healey have taken a more deliberate public process and consulted with, worked through the legislature? Yes. The context in which she's taken these steps are one in which We've had more mass shootings in this country than there were calendar days last year. We've had 8 officers killed in recent months in this state alone. We had 2 shot very critically last night using an assault rifle. And so you can understand the context in which she's making sure that cops are not shot in Massachusetts. And so for that reason, I'm willing to continue to work with her on this issue.
For the record, more people have been killed with their hands and feet, just so that you know. And that information is out there.
Yeah, but I think we'll stick with the rules.
Okay.
All right, thank you. Gene, another question from the audience, please. This one for Adam.
This one's for Adam, yes. You will represent a large district with many small towns. How will you be sure you are serving them all?
This has come up a lot. At 5 o'clock, I was at an event in Lenox and said, I've got to go, I have a debate in Ashfield. And people were just amazed at the fact that it's 52 towns and communities. I'm not sure if everyone here is aware of that. So it's all of Berkshire County and then half of Franklin, New Hampshire, and 2 towns in Camden. There's 2 things. One, Ben Downing has done incredibly well at making sure that he was involved in local conversations. I like that approach. Secondly, even though his office was based in Pittsfield, I would probably do the same, but ensure that any staff member is out in the hill towns at least once a week, similarly maybe North County, maybe South County. I like being very deliberate about making sure that we're involved in working closely with select boards and others and being available. Your attention to the small towns is one that I want to emphasize tonight as well, in that there's been recently this year a summit of small towns based in meeting in Toronto. And it's abundantly clear that we have unique challenges in small towns. And whether it's exploring possibilities around shared resources or addressing regulations, state regulations that unduly impact us out here, it's important that we are very deliberate about identifying the differences that we face as small towns. And so what you get in me is someone who grew up in a small town and somebody who is currently living in one part of the district, worked in another part, in the northwestern part of the state, and is from here with family members here. And so what's great about that background is it means that you remain in touch with all aspects of this vast district that is the largest in the state.
Chris?
I think in the digital age, it's a lot easier to keep people together. I think it's very important time management. I also think it's important for you to know that I grew up in Pittsfield and was born in Pittsfield, but now live in the hill towns. And it's important to know the different needs because you're dealing with city councils versus selectmen that have warrants. And so these needs are gonna have to be balanced. And I think one thing I've always done, and I've done focus groups and think tanks, because you need to bring people together. It can't be a unilateral decision. It's the will of the people and what the people need. So for me, I think it's active communication with myself, with the leaders, with the people, and getting constant feedback and working with it and really prioritizing. I have a policy. If someone contacts me, I'm back to them within 48 hours, latest.
Thank you both. Kathy, back to you.
So Christine.
Oh.
Go back. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. In this rural area, there's a serious shortage of housing appropriate for seniors. Do you have any innovative ideas to increase housing options for older residents?
During the years that I worked, I did some work with Peace Corps in different areas, and my daughter's thinking about going to Haiti right now, and they do build villages. That's not appropriate necessarily here, but let me use that same basic concept to answer. Elderly housing needs to be affordable. When you retire, I want you to think about your financial security. First of all, some people and many people live paycheck to paycheck. Those who have saved can be eaten right away when they go to live in assisted living or nursing homes. Further, if they are living alone, they need to have safe housing and not housing where people can show fear or intimidation or try to rid them of their money. I think one of the innovative things we can do is really work with concepts for Section 8 or housing, for humanity, Habitat for Humanity, sorry about that. You know, and there are ways that we can work together to find this more affordable housing, but it also has to be handicap accessible. It should be near main roads, and it should also be on bus routes where we're closer to healthcare. And there has to be a lot more forethought put into it because the aging population is growing. So these are things that I think should be happening with the housing.
Three things come to mind. One is there is happening at the federal level, and I've heard this from again from Dave Christopoulos, where in the Hilltown CDC, where essentially there's a tax credit and there's grants available for housing developments, but in rural areas we're often we don't have the quantity of units to qualify for them. And so working with our federal delegation to ensure that when we have a housing unit of 20, that you would qualify for that. That's one thing. The Housing Stabilization Fund at the state level is one that I would ensure that funds are diverted to ensure that we can fulfill that fund. There's a lot of older homes that could use rehabilitation, and making sure that we're using our existing stock of homes is another priority. We see that in a lot of downtown areas or really throughout the district where there's a bit of a win-win there where if we invest in rehabilitating older homes and create more housing availability. And I already mentioned the housing stock in Goshen where it is downtown, in the center of town, and one that's been developed through the CDC and others. To me, it starts to point to an important role for the state senate, and that is, you know, if you're playing that mediator role between the developers, between the state and local agencies, to ensure that we have a vision for what we're going to do to address some of these needs. And so we need somebody who can play that role. I think the state senator is well placed to do that, and I would hope to do so. Thank you.
Thank you. Diane, question for Adam.
This year, local regional school districts formed the Massachusetts Rural Schools Coalition to address common problems. As Senator, would you support rural school aid to offset rising costs? And if so, what would you do to get support for this measure from colleagues serving more populated sections of the state?
Emphatically, yes. To describe what we're talking about, in I think it was Wisconsin, they initially had the scarcity aid, and essentially it's saying, okay, we have the current foundation budget formula in Chapter 70 that has an allocation to districts, and it's not enough. We know, I mentioned already, we have a shortfall here in Mohawk, but I'm sure it's the same for Gateway in Hampshire. Instead, we're saying, look, we need to look at population density. We need to look at our enrollment numbers. They've been going down steadily. We need to look at the Chapter 70 allocation, and we also look at per capita income. When you put all that together, it shows that we're not getting nearly what we need to just maintain the curriculum, just maintain the quality education that we need in the context of declining enrollment and fixed costs related to aging buildings and the like. And so, absolutely yes. I'm happy that Superintendent Bunnicani is already laying the groundwork, in part by creating a coalition of rural schools. So this starts to answer your second question, which is you need to draw on a coalition throughout the state. The problem with some of the issues that we're facing, and the other one being regional school transportation, I probably don't have to tell this crowd that the state agreed to fund 100% when regionalization of high schools took place, whatever that was, five decades ago. And has only reimbursed it currently at around 70%. And so that means there's several hundred dollars that we need to come up with out of the operational budget. It's just not fair. And so, you know, in when you look at the state legislature, there's 200 of them out there, senators and House of Representatives. I think about a third of them actually are in a district that even touches a regional school district. And so you can understand the dynamics of why it's difficult to get support for these types of measures, but it's one that that I would advocate for strongly, partly by creating that coalition, and also just by making the argument and how we get at the interests of everyone in the Commonwealth. And to me, that means, you know, we've been talking about earlier in this conversation, what are we going to do to inspire millennials to come to the Commonwealth or to come to these areas? And so it's, you can't make that argument to bring in new workers to the state, to bring in new companies to the state, if you can't point to the best schools around it. So it's all part of the equation. I'm so glad that you brought it up, because it's one that I would look forward to working with school committee members and Superintendent Bunakati on pretty forcefully.
Thank you, Chris.
This is an important topic when the MRC is trying to address. Actually, I've given talks on Chapter 70 funding, and here's the basics. I actually hunted down the guy at the Department of Elementary and Secondary Ed. He's still working, waiting for retirement. When he originally made that deal back in 67 or 68 with Mount Everett, it was 100% reimbursement, and he himself will tell you it was the dangling carrot for regionalization and for school districts to bite. They promised them 100%. Well, few years in, they started to realize they made bad legislation, and they added this little clause called subject to appropriation. Because of subject to appropriation, now the best, like Adam said, I talked to the guy, you're gonna get 71%. Some years it's been 63%. As a senator, I would sit down and explain to people how to do the formulation budget and how to really look at your spend population, your ELL populations, your money populations, and see how you can make a better formula for you. Because every town will get some money, even places like Lincoln Sudbury.
Thank you. Question for Chris.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. How will you work to help and protect small farms in the district?
I'm already on that. It was interesting. Adam and I both attended it was a meeting of farmers to really hear what their needs were. And I've been working about the APR. And right now what that is if you're growing food on your farm, the state will buy portions of it so it can't be developed. But what they're not telling families until the end, basically, is we all die. I know that's hard. I just was reading a thing where millennials think they won't. And so if you want to become a death counselor for millennials, there'll be a job for you in the future. But for the rest of us, and when it comes to farms, only one child can inherit the farm. And so it's dividing families, and it's a big problem. Also with small farms, I really would like to have micro distilleries, repurpose our land in agriculture, and I put out in my 15-point economic plan, long live Cheech and Chong. I would really like to pass the marijuana bill and the hemp bill, because they're billion-dollar industries for pharma, beauty, and many other things such as plastics that I really think could bring in real sustainable long-term jobs that have professional, mid-level, skilled and unskilled positions for our people. And I think it would save our farms, because right now only 10% of us outside of Massachusetts, suburban or metropolitan areas live in these rural areas. And the farmers told us they are making only 10% of the food, and it's basically in our area, and they can't keep up with the prices. They're also having problems. For example, in Berkshire County, they don't have a slaughterhouse. So now we have a question on the ballot about the treatment of animals. Well, as many of you know, with Muslims, they have halal, we have kosher. There are ways if we had a slaughterhouse where we could also be more humane to the animal, and we really have to start listening to what the farmers need and working with them and their subsidies and their taxes. And that's where I stand on that issue.
Big issue, because just looking around here, that's why I grew up down the road, so on 112 you have the Willises, and they're making the dairy farm work, but man, they're in the minority right now. 30 years ago there were over 600 dairy farms in Massachusetts, now the number is, I believe, below 200. It's just mind-boggling, actually, the direction we're headed in, and because when you have prices of milk changing and the price of transportation changing, there's a lot of obstacles for sustaining your livelihood as a farmer. I made a priority of meeting with friends of ours up at Sidehill Farm, because they've taken a different approach, which is saying, well, why don't we go the value-added route and making a top-notch yogurt that you can literally find throughout the state. That's one example. So what are we going to do about value-added and ensuring that our small farms can do that? The other is farm-to-institution relationships. I think that making sure that our schools have local, fresh food is a priority, and so is stopping quickly. Yeah.
Thank you. Jean, audience question.
I guess this goes to Adam.
It does.
Knowing that our climate is rapidly degrading, floods, droughts, fires, what do you know of Senator Barrett's bill, number 1747, and would you support it?
That's a climate pricing, I'm pretty sure, correct? Is that the climate pricing bill from Barrett? Yes.
Yeah.
I do support climate pricing, carbon tax. It's basically, we're past the point of no return, as many will point out. We've made good steps as moving towards, you know, investments in energy as a commonwealth. Many of you will know that we had the energy bill that passed this last term meant that we're going to invest in offshore wind in a dramatic new way. And such that is really unprecedented, almost in the country, because we're well placed as a commonwealth and we need to continue to do that. And so that's been one priority of mine, is making sure that we continue in that direction. For example, we invested, I'm going to get into the weeds a little bit here, but we invested for 1,600 megawatts. The Senate version had 2,000, and it was very deliberate. It was trying to say, look, if we invest at that level, in 10 years, we'll be getting to cost parity for renewable sources of energy versus fossil fuels in this offshore potential that we have here. We live in a market economy, so we need to demonstrate to industries and customers that there will be investments, and they should therefore invest in those renewable energy technologies. So solar is another example. We have the net metering cap in Massachusetts. It's time to get rid of the cap altogether. It's time to make sure that we have a comprehensive energy plan that businesses can get behind too. When I talk with some of the major manufacturers in the district, they say, okay, that's great, we all want to get there eventually, but just help us out in the meantime. Give us some transparency, some visibility. You know, there were some disappointing parts to the energy bill. It didn't have any requirements for the renewable portfolio standards. And so I would work this year to try to make sure that was as a part of it. When this bill was passed this year, Senate President Rosenberg said, it's a step, but it's not a leap in the right direction. So I'm pretty sure the Senate will be continuing to take it up. One thing, since I have more time, that I try to make clear when I release my environmental and energy priorities is, you know, we can benefit from the fact that there are going to be more and more investments in renewable energy. And so why are we not making sure that we are getting the jobs here in creating solar panels, in making sure that we're investing in our local towns and what they can do to get to a net zero district. The bottom line is we're at a bit of a crossroads in the Commonwealth when it comes to our energy future. And on the one hand, we have major power plants going offline in several years to come. And at the same time, we have a lot of businesses crushed under the weight of energy costs. At the same time, we are far behind in meeting our own goals towards climate change. We've, as a Commonwealth, have said we're going to get to 25% below 1990 carbon emissions by 2020. Apparently, we're closer to 11%, and so we do need to adjust our path.
Thank you. Chris?
I'm one of two Republicans that have just been congratulated by energy groups that want to protect the environment. I'm only one of two Republicans who have said outright, I will protect our environment. I have a problem with agencies like Kinder Morgan and their pipeline, and I'm open about it. But I do support solar energy and wind energy. I live on Lanesboro-Hancock border, and we have the windmills, and they're fabulous. I've tried to do solar. I believe that we should take capped garbage areas and put the solar panels on them and hook in the higher wires. And that way, we can have them in areas where we don't necessarily have to see them, but they could really use the town. And I was talking to one town administrator, and they were looking how they could pay themselves off in the next 30 years and how much it could save towns if we were to invest now. So I think it's a great idea, and I think we need to reduce our carbon footprint.
Thank you, Jean. By the way, thank you, Chris, for continuing to ferry up these questions. Jean, another audience question, please.
Okay, I have a couple on this one, so I think it's important I get to ask it. It's, what is your position on natural gas pipelines going through conserved land that are protected by Article 97?
Is that minor?
It's Chris.
As I said, I'm against the Morgan Pipeline and Kinder Morgan, and so much so that here's the thing. When I went in, I first read their financials. They brought in billions and billions of dollars and then offered Marlboro $30,000. And I was quoted in the paper as saying, what do they think we are, the Beverly Hillbillies? And it caught their attention there and then. What they've done, if you actually read, even environmental studies, they have used pipelines that have actually broken and have led to sickness. And if you don't know, my husband died of environmental leukemia. So there will be no day under my watch that they will ever put a pipeline in. I will not accept their blood money, and they will have it. It's out. And let me tell you why it's out of the eastern end of the state. Our good governor, Charlie Baker, has taken money. If you go through his OCPF financials, he's taken money from Kinder Morgan, Nixon Peabody, and that's why it's still on the table at this end of the state. I think you need me in there as a voice and a fellow Republican of him to tell him the answer is no. There will be no pipeline at the expense of our people. And that's basically where I stand. I don't want to waste your time going on and on, but for me, the answer is point blank no.
Yeah, I've been very clearly against all the pipelines. So the Tennessee, the Ned, and now what you're referring to is Article 97 impacts another pipeline that is lesser known, but in the state forest in Sandusfield. And what's, I guess, concerning about it is that it's saying that we, the Commonwealth, has protected lands under Article 97, and it's essentially saying, that's great, but federal law supersedes state law, so we're gonna go through anyway. And so that's deeply concerning for the precedent it sets for any potential future pipelines. By the way, given what I just said in my previous answer, I think you it's pretty clear that my priority is, why are we not investing more in green energy at this moment? The other thing that's concerning about the treatment of Article 97 is it points to how outdated FERC is, right? So this is a federal regulation body that's essentially tasked with promoting energy development. And there's a mismatch with evolving technologies in energy efficiency and energy renewable energy sources. And so that's something that absolutely needs to be addressed.
Thank you both. Kathy, question for Adam, please.
Right, you both touched on the need for transportation out in this rural area. Do you have specific ideas on how to expand it and support it?
This is a tough one, because people have been trying to get this right for decades and decades and decades. And you know, when I was working with Congressman Olver 16 years ago, it was at the top of his list, and he was the head of the Transportation Committee and Appropriations, and it remains a challenge. I come at it from a couple of ways. One is, it's getting us what we absolutely need to, what we deserve in terms of funding and in terms of getting our access around the area, but then also to major economic centers. So think of, you know, if folks could commute into Boston or not, or to New York or elsewhere. And so on the one hand, what are we doing locally? To me, that means making sure that you have probably a hybrid of using technology and the Ubers and Lyft and others, so that they're linking up with major infrastructure, transportation infrastructure, if it's bus or otherwise. It's a difficult challenge in a rural area. I'll just flag for a second an example, being in the Northern Berkshires, where the state has invested $500,000 every year to try to address this, and it still isn't working, and the state said, this is the last year. And so there have been attempts to come up with, let's divide the costs. Can you have an employer, an employee in the state divide a kind of a taxi service that helps people get to jobs? And it turns out that employers didn't want to do that either. And so I bring that up just to say that this is an ongoing conversation that I would love to be at the center of. It's an absolute priority. I did reference the trains, and I think that's something that needs more energy. And I say that because it's been off the books for quite some time. Senator Lesser down in the East Hampton area has recently passed this session to have East-West a study done. And so I would make sure that goes throughout the district, and even we can have transportation linking up to that process if it eventually happens. So that's a tough one, and I really look forward to rolling up my sleeves and getting in the middle of this transportation question.
Thank you, Chris.
In 30 seconds. I think local transportation, especially in areas like Pittsfield and outlying areas, will need second and third shift buses. People can and cannot get to work. And only in our areas, I had a man come to me. He has to walk down into Dalton, and he has coyotes chasing him, and he wants to take his shotgun on the B bus. And I explained to him, well, that can't happen. But, you know, these are things that we have to look into. Again, like I say with the train, if they can get a train to go from Wasaic down to New York City, we could certainly bring it up at least to Barrington and bring the one from Springfield to Pittsfield. So we have the same opportunities with the MBTA or MTA to go right into the city and work. And also, Cape Cod offers a bus for all of its citizens to go to Boston once a week for its hospital appointments. And I think we should implement that from our different counties as well.
Thank you. Diane, a question for Chris.
Franklin County has lost many of its tool manufacturers and paper mills over the last 25 years. What would you do to bring back jobs and reinvigorate the economy?
So you lost two manufacturers?
Tool manufacturers.
Okay. First of all, we have a big problem when it comes to business, and this is sort of one of my specialties here. When I was looking at the economic plan for businesses, there is no incentive for business to come into Massachusetts. People laughed at me when I said, we're Taxachusetts. The truth is, we're in the top 8 states for taxing, and corporations don't come. With us bordering on New York, we have the 10-10-10. Why would you come here if you're over there? So that's why places are closing. Because what you have to understand is there's a corporate tax, then there's a Massachusetts tax, and then there's your profit. And off of that, people who do payroll will tell you, you're paying 30% on to these taxes, then you're having to pay another 20% for FICA and everything else that gets added on. The bills get so high that there isn't a reason, and it's cheaper to close and go elsewhere. Also, we need to look at NAFTA, and we have to look at the WTO and our trading agreements. It's hurt us, and it's hurt us badly. And for people to come back here, I think we have to really remarket our area. We have to make it a destination. We have to look at bringing manufacturers here because we have really skilled people. And we have quality, hard-working people. So I think if I were doing it for business, I want to lower the corporate taxes. I want to ensure people are getting fair wages and that the government is not stepping in trying to break up unions. I think that's a big problem. Like right now, if you haven't noticed, you're going to notice a lot of nurses going, because right now Charlie Baker in his wisdom wants to get people who do not have medical certifications to give you medicines. This is wrong. We have to have someone in there who will stand up to them. And a lot of these people, they know what they know, but they don't understand business. And if you want to drive business, you have to give them something to come for. Tool making is a great business. And we have vocational schools. You got Smith, you've got McCann, you've got Taconic. Every one of those people, they have a skill, and we can really repurpose it, especially with the robotics coming up, the pipeline of nanotechnology. We just have to learn how to remarket it.
Thank you, Adam.
Well, it's true. It's interesting you mentioned the tool companies. My father moved to the area to start and to run an upholstery tool company, but it's no longer around, so it's another part of those statistics, I suppose. It is interesting, though, that in Franklin, Hampshire County, 10% of the workforce is still on manufacturing. And so doubling down and making sure that at least the where we do have manufacturing taking place, that there's workforce that's ready to join there. And so investing in our vocational schools is a priority. I've heard continuously throughout this campaign, employers coming to us and saying, we don't have the workers we need. How can we align our workforce? So that's a big one, strategic workforce development for the jobs that are available and then the jobs we might have. That often means things like educational institutions, healthcare institutions. Down the road, we're looking more at healthcare providers for homes and down the like and the like. And I think that that's something that we need to make sure that our colleges are training for, GCC's training for. And then our infrastructure and a bunch of other things, but I'll get to it in another question.
Thank you. Stephanie, question for Adam.
This is for Adam, yes. So in our state primary, in all of the competitive races for state rep, state senate, sheriff's races, the candidate that raised the most money won, including yourself. Do you believe that money has too much influence in our elections? And if so, what campaign finance reforms would you like to see in Massachusetts?
I am deeply concerned about campaign finance and would prioritize campaign finance reform. It's true that I raised the most money in my primary. It's also true that I had the most individual contributors than more than any other state senate candidate in this district since we've had filing online. But it's absolutely the case that you have to be able to afford to take many months off without an income. I've personally been on unpaid leave since June. And so if that in itself means that we're going to be limiting who's running for office and kind of having an impact on democracy, that's unacceptable. And so I'm all for finding ways to not only bring transparency to the process, some of the items off the top of my head that I've seen discussed include, it's visible immediately rather than during the reporting period. You have more police on the beat, in quotes, i.e. folks who are actually doing the research to ensure that candidates and politicians are actually fulfilling the laws that are on the books already. And down the line, continuing to work on limiting the level of contributions, etc. To me, it's absolutely critical. We've seen that there's a difference between the number of contributions and the amount that a person can give. And to me, so I don't shy away from the fact that as a result of doing a lot of work in the community, we've had a broad-based support and a lot of folks who think that I'll be a strong voice for Western Mass. And I think that's where the bottom line has been reflected. But it's absolutely a priority of mine to deal with it in this state center.
Chris.
I've taken two endorsements but refuse to take any financial gaining with them. Because when you buy an endorsement, what they do is give you pretty much a contract telling you how your vote will go. And I'm not bought by anyone. I do what's right by people. I do think the money has to be limited. Adam is right. I've had to take 6 months off of working and getting contracts to be able to do this. And also, I think that sometimes when there's an unequal amount of money, I've had to call my campaign David versus Goliath. What he did with $72,000, I did on $2,950 and spent every donor dollar as if it were my own. And I also have a problem. I openly say this, out of his campaign money, $15,000 went towards political image consultants and $6,000 was paid directly to an elected city councilor in Pittsfield as an advisor. To me, that is wrong, and I will publicly say it is wrong, because everyone should have a voice and a vote.
Thank you. Jean, a question for Chris.
I have a couple of questions on this subject about regionalization. Are you in favor of regionalization? Should towns pool, share their resources, such as police, fire, public works, to reduce cost and provide services?
Yes. We have to really look at the numbers and how our campaigns, and for example, with volunteer fire departments. I just was talking to someone in this room about how grants are given and who gets what truck. Look, at the bottom line is schools are coming down in size. You're not going to have enough students. You're not going to be able to do the upkeep. We have to share services, whether it means sharing a superintendent for two districts, 3 days here, 2 days there, or having part-time. We need to really look at how we're going to take our budgets and look at how they work. Why can't we have one town administrator? I know it's hard for some people because these are the jobs, but the reality is we don't have the population to justify the expenditures. And a lot of people, I know, are having to sell their homes because they can't afford the taxes to live in their towns. So in that sense, yes, I do feel we have to do regionalization. If we work as a team, we will do better.
Great. I'm going to start by answering the questions about the $15,000 and the $6,000. The $15,000 was my male consultant, and so yes, it's expensive, but it's not an image consultant, although they did help develop the mail. But that was part of how you get the word out and get your name out as part of any campaign. And the $6,000 to my field director is a city councilor whose profession is political consulting, and so she's a paid staffer. She's currently also paid by the Hillary campaign. She's previously run the coordinated campaign in Berkshire County in 2014, and so that's her private profession. When it comes to shared services, absolutely. It's great to see that there's been in Tralmont a bit of a summit of small towns and discussing just these questions. What are we doing about the fact that I think Tralmont itself can't afford new cars for the police department and Department of Public Works? And so there probably are a lot of areas where it makes sense to share services. It's probably other areas where it doesn't. So it's a bit of a case-by-case basis, but I'm all for it.
Thank you. Jean, another one of your questions.
A little different subject here. Regarding the opioid crisis in all our communities, what exactly is the task force doing and how successful has the approach been? What would your approach be?
Brad.
I've been proud to receive the endorsement of all co-chairs of the Franklin County Opioid Task Force, the sheriff, the DA, registered, Merrigan. This is something that I've been involved in my current job. It's an absolute epidemic. It's a crisis that we have to go all in on. And so, to me, in terms of what they're doing and what we should be doing, it's slightly different. I won't dwell too much on what they're doing, but in my current role in Northern Berkshire County, one of the things that we did, we actually partnered with the Franklin County Opioid Task Force in getting Narcan available to police. Well, police in North Adams, but getting Narcan available to first responders. And there's an unfortunate statistic that followed. This was in April. We had, I think within 5 days of the police in North Adams receiving Narcan, so by the way, Narcan is the overdose reversal drug, it was used 7 times on 4 individuals. It just shows you how dire the situation has become. Essentially a three-pronged approach. On the prevention side, it's of course, what are we doing about our prescription drug monitoring programs? The legislation this year in Massachusetts goes a long way to making sure that we can keep track of who's getting these opiates and who's not. We know that 80% of current heroin users started with prescription drugs, some recreational one, some for pain management. But being better at that is a priority. By the way, in Atlanta this year, I attended a national summit on this, and there are some promising changes in medicine coming down the pipeline, i.e. how do you have pain medicine that isn't addictive, it doesn't give you the high that these do. And so we need to make sure at the federal level that those investments continue. When it comes to treatment and intervention, I'm glad that there's now family drug courts in the region. Because this, we're not going to arrest our way out of this, but we do need to take advantage of those crisis points. It might be going into an emergency department, and it might be going into a courtroom, but that's the moment when we need to grab folks and start to ensure that there is the potential for movement towards treatment. And so I'm encouraged by ensuring that we have funding for recovery coaches, for example, and I'll work with colleagues on that in the Senate. And then finally, on the treatment and recovery side, you know, we just simply don't have enough in terms of treatment facilities or the ability to pay for folks who need to go. And so one thing that I would prioritize is working to ensure that insurance companies don't have the current policy of failing first in outpatient services or arbitrarily limiting the length of stay in treatment facilities. Right now it's typically around 14 days when we know that really it's those 1 month or more that's required. And so in this issue, delays or shortened stays can have life and death consequences. And then finally, I would just say that this issue in particular feels personal just because people who I grew up with in this area are no longer with us as a result of it.
Thank you, Chris.
4 out of 5 people become addicted from paid prescriptions. I want to see doctors held accountable that are prescribing this stuff and how much they are through transparency. I also think we have to get over the stigmas in our society. I've met a lot of people who are afraid to get help because of what other people will think. Opioids don't care what you look like or what socioeconomic class you're in. I think lastly, we have to look at protecting children, especially children of people on opioids, because we're seeing the problems in the school. And more importantly, we have to work with insurance companies. I just finished talking with one who told me how the insurance companies really control the treatment, and it needs to stop. People are human beings, and we have to help them.
Thank you, Kathy. Question for Chris.
Okay. All right.
attack the internet, just on a and broadband in a different way. I'm getting more and more input from folks that are trying to sell their homes in this area and won't even have anybody come look at them because they don't have access to internet, never mind broadband. Some people still on dial-up. Also, as far as medical services go, a lot of those are now internet-based, cardiac monitors, different features that really are required to use the internet for communicating with your doctor. How do you plan to support the current efforts and the shift with MBI and Wired West out here?
I think one of the things we first have to do is get broadband. I live out in a hill town, and I too have this issue, and I run two e-commerce-based businesses where I have to do contracts, Skyping, and it becomes difficult because I get bounced off. Broadband is great, but it's really going out the door now. White light is going to be the next thing coming up, and it's cheaper and it's faster, and it's a lot of things what the government uses now. So we really have to look at, is the reason they're bringing broadband finally to us because it's going out the door and we're going to be getting their pickup, which is not right. White light is cheaper and we need to send it out to procurement. Right now there are a few companies who say to us, this is what we'll offer. But there hasn't been out on combis, which goes through our operational service division, real procurement possibilities. And if I was in the Senate, I would bring this out to procurement to make sure we all get it. Because we have to have business without borders, e-commerce, and we should be able to connect to do things. And when it comes to medical, I will reveal I'm a diabetic, okay? And as a diabetic, I've also had some heart issues. And I need to have that hooked up, like you say, to a computer, and sometimes that's very difficult to do it manually. So I would definitely support it 100% as one who understands and has faced these issues. One of the biggest problems we do have is that we have to stand together. I've had people fight with me and literally say to me, we shouldn't have broadband. If you want broadband, don't plan to live out in the country. I'm sorry. You don't have to buy it yourself, but we should at least have it available to all citizens. Okay, and that's where I stand on that. And I would fight from it from a procurement view and get us the highest and the best price, and I would definitely look into white light.
Yeah, I mean, I'd be curious to hear how folks feel about the independent municipal network that Ashfield just signed on to, because it's encouraging that we're finally getting to the point where we see the end game on the horizon, 18 months maybe from now, but it's there. And so I'd be curious to hear, to sit down maybe after at 9 o'clock to discuss that with folks. But that's the encouraging part. Since we started this campaign, since that was 6-7 months ago, it was absolutely appalling that we could go into the majority of the towns in the district and there was no sense of where folks were headed and how we're gonna get there. And so it's real estate, but it's also kids doing homework, it's also economic development and down the line, safety in many cases. Similarly, now Buckland and Shelburne and a few others have signed on a different model, right? So we now have 5 models from the governor and the administration. So I'd be curious to hear if we think that partnering with Comcast with an investment from MBI is the way to go. The bottom line is, as state senator, I want to make sure that the town preference is what's pursued, and it's affordable, and that it's accessible, and that we're getting to the 100% mark.
Thank you. Diane? By the way, may I just say one thing? Just following up on what Adam just said, if folks want to stay around for a few minutes and to meet the candidates afterwards, please do. This is going to go until 9 o'clock, and then let's get up front and up close and personal, I think. Thank you, Diane.
Okay, with the current presidential election, partisanship and polarization seems to be growing. If elected, how will you be able to work? How well will you be able to work with leaders of the opposite party in the legislature and administration?
Yeah, this is for me. This is really something that a lot of folks have pointed to. When Ben Downing said he was no longer running, folks said, hey, you know, we've seen you draw on that negotiation experience from the Middle East and bring it into local issues and making sure that the whole spectrum of needs are brought to the table. when confronting major challenges in the community. That's what folks brought to my attention as the reason I should be running, and that is why I'm running. Because we, as I said in my opening remarks, we absolutely have to do politics differently. That's the reason I'm running the race, is because, quite frankly, I'm disgusted by how politics typically does take place. And it's often either the negative attacks or the negativity in general, or wedge issues that divide the electorate very cynically. And so instead, to me, it's about overcoming our challenges together. And so in a district like this, it's even more critical, because when we're talking about things like what we're gonna do to unite small towns and the like, we better do it together. And it's only when we join together that we're going to address our priorities at the statewide level, such as accelerating the transition to green energy while meeting energy costs for local businesses. And that building those coalitions is something I've spent a career doing. It's something that we need to do to actually be effective on Beacon Hill. And so it's true in the Senate. What's the current breakdown? 34 Democrats and 6 Republicans, I think, and obviously Republican governor. I would pride myself on making sure that we're taking an issues-based approach to getting the priorities of this district taken care of.
Go ahead, Chris, thank you.
Well, I'm a team player and bipartisan, just so you know, 30% of my committee is Democrat, a lot of independents, libertarians, a few Republicans, there aren't many of us out there here in this area. So I really have been working with everybody. My whole life I have, even at 23, my neighbors were the Taliban. I've worked with all groups around the world, and so I've had to learn to be culturally sensitive, be diplomatic. And I tell you now, and I think I can speak for Adam on this one, neither one of us would ever behave like Hillary and Donald. Okay? I've been disgusted with that behavior. Would you not say that? Is that the first statement? Do you want me to stand over the back?
Why don't we just,
No, I think that's one thing, whichever one of us gets in, I think a very fair thing to say is we both work well with people. And I think that's a fair statement with everyone.
Thank you for that. Stephanie, question for Chris.
Yes. Levels of inequality in Massachusetts lead the nation, yet we have one of the most regressive state tax incomes in the country. The lowest fifth of income earners pay around 10% of their income, while the top 1% with salaries over $860,000 annually pay around 6.5% of their income. I know you call Massachusetts Taxachusetts, but do you support a graduated income tax rate, more specifically, the Fair Share Amendment, also dubbed the Millionaire Tax, Massachusetts residents will vote on in 2018, that would raise the tax rate by 4 percentage points on all income after the first $1 million? With dollars earmarked for schools and infrastructure?
Yes, I would. And my party does not agree with me, and I've told them, too bad. On this one, there are people out there, and I happen to have a brother who falls into that category. So I called him up and I said, hey, John, what do you think about the millionaire's tax? You know what he did? And I'm a teacher, I've been a teacher for years, so my salary has never been at that level and never will be. He laughed at me and he says, what do you mean? I'll go down from 680 to 620 after taxes? What do you think I am, not going out to Olive Garden? And that's when I put my foot down and said, well, you know what, if you can afford that, I've got people in my counties who have to hunt deer for their dinner for the winter. I've seen a lot of people who are homeless, vets who need things. So call me Robin Hood, because I have no problem taking from the percentage of millionaires and giving out to the schools and those in need, because we should share and be less fortunate. Just so you know, that must be the Democratic father side coming out in me. But absolutely, I agree with it. I think it has to be. Where I do think we need to cut taxes, though, is at the middle class, because I do find a lot of families are being stretched too far, and I shouldn't see families working 2 and 3 jobs and deciding, as one family told me with kids, do I pick propane or do I pick food? Okay, not acceptable with me. So for me, the millionaires, they will get taxed, and if they have a question, they can come talk to me.
I do agree with your assessment that the flat tax disproportionately punishes working families just trying to fight for a secure the future. And I do support the Fair Share Amendment. And it's largely because we're watching wage stagnation, and we're watching the fact that we have an increasingly unfairness problem in our tax system in Massachusetts. And so this concept of Taxachusetts just is no longer true. There are 21 states that collect more in income taxes than Massachusetts alone, and folks just forget that. Yeah, I guess I'll stop there.
Thank you. Gene, from the audience.
I think, Adam?
Yes.
What specific measures have you taken to attract first-time voters and young voters to the political process?
That's a great one. We've had two superstars in our campaign this year, both from college, and that's one of the things we tasked them with, is what are we going to do to get folks excited? And so it's the obvious things that in terms of social media, but it's also a message that resonates to me. It's a little disingenuous to hear folks saying, you know, we need to get the right medium right. It's actually also about getting a message that's inspiring for young folks and getting them to think that government is going to be relevant. And so whether we're talking about college affordability or basic fairness in society, I think that those are the things that younger folks are getting excited about. It is true that we've been very deliberate about making sure that our, you know, we're Twitter accounts and we have Facebook accounts that are doing a lot to reach out. But to me, it's really some fundamental issues.
Good.
Same thing. I've encouraged young people to join. I've gone out to schools. I'm actually speaking at two schools. And getting kids to talk about politics. Before, I have to tell you, I've met so many people on the trail, and I'm sure Adam has as well. They tell me they don't vote. They don't think their vote counts. And I tell them, your vote is your voice. You're lucky to be in a country where you have the opportunity to vote. I've been in countries where I've worked under dictators. And actually with Syrians, I've worked with them, and they told me the only place you can open your mouth is a dentist office. So I beg them heartily to please go out and vote. And I also think it's interesting because even my own daughter, now she was supporting Bernie, okay? And she said to me, well, Bernie's gonna get us all free education. And it was then I started to learn the civics classes aren't necessarily telling about other branches of government and how it works. So it's really opened opportunities, I think, for parents to be able to talk to their kids.
Gene, another question, this time for Chris.
You've discussed a variety of issues, but you can't devote your attention to all of them. What are your passions, and how would you express them in primary legislation that you would introduce?
So are you asking what kind of new laws would I like to introduce?
Yeah, what's your passions?
I think one of my passions has always been being a voice for the voiceless. That's why I've done whistleblower. I do not like discrimination in any form. And we have a lot of it going on, and I think we should support the Massachusetts Commission Against Discrimination more, especially as I go around and I find a lot of males over the age of 40 that are not able to compete with men who are 20. People are saying they don't want them anymore, especially in construction jobs. Or we have people, for example, like me. I am not in a protected class, and I've been made fun of because of my weight. People have made discriminatory remarks. Actually, one of the reasons I went over to the Middle East, when I was 22 or something around that area, I finished my first master's, and I had trained in linguistics and wanted to work for the CIA. And the guy looked at me when I went into the interview and said, wouldn't you be embarrassed representing the United States at your weight? And I said, no more embarrassed than you are with that gap between your teeth. Needless to say, the interview ended. But my whole life, people have made remarks, and I think it's something where people should judge you by your character and your merit, not by your outer shell. So if I were to be able to pass something, I'd love a pan-person act. And what it would say is, you look at what the person has done without relevance to race, creed, whatever it may be, so that everyone has opportunities. And the second bill I'd like to pass is one for domestic violence abuse, so that women don't have to take time off, or men who are abused by their partners in the court system, whether it be by Skype, and that we have better systems, that it doesn't take three times to get a harassment order. If someone is stalking you or hitting you, it needs to stop and stop there. And I think lastly, if I were to pass one other bill, I would like to see reform if teachers or school committee members specifically know that things are going wrong and they cover them up, and it endangers the health, welfare, or safety of a child, even though a school committee cannot be sued, that individual who took no action and endangered the child should be held responsible. At the current time, we do not have these things.
Thank you.
I have to say, the more we spend talking with folks and traveling to every single town in this district, we've mentioned a few of my passions, which is going to be making sure that we're filing legislation on education reform and funding reform and helping small towns and getting those rural exceptions, etc. So that's pretty high on the top of the list. For me, poverty is a big one. And because the implications go so far and wide, whether it's criminal justice reform, whether it's watching, you know, our health indicators, and just basic lack of fairness that we see in our society, it's a big one, and it's one that is far-reaching, and it's one that I would really dig into, because we've watched as, you know, just as an example, where we stand with the minimum wage. It's a poverty wage in Massachusetts, because we've seen that if you had a minimum wage in 1968 and applied it today, it'd be closer to $18, and meanwhile, making a minimum wage right now, you're below the federal poverty line if, God forbid, you have two kids. And so, it's to me, there's a bit of a mismatch that has emerged, and it's not something that we can be proud of as Americans.
Thank you. Kathy, a question for Adam.
The federal SHIP program, known in Massachusetts as the SHINE program, serving the health insurance needs of elders, is administered through the state. The funding for the program is right now in jeopardy. If the federal funding doesn't come through, how will you be able to support being able to provide free health insurance counseling and information to Massachusetts older residents?
Wow. That's a big question, because you're basically talking about how would we readjust the budget, how would we find other locations for it. I mean, the bottom line is it's a priority, right? I've glanced or given a nod to a couple of priorities. In this past term, Senator Rosenberg had a provision for ensuring that we have bulk funding for, or bulk, I guess, payment for purchasing. There, that's the word. Bulk purchasing for prescription drugs in MassHealth, and we don't. And so there's elements like that that I think we need to pursue in healthcare in Massachusetts. 40% of our budget in Massachusetts goes to healthcare. It's outrageous, and this is a $40 billion budget. And so there are clearly ways that we need to streamline that or find ways that we're spending it in a better way. I've come out in favor of single-payer healthcare because I think that that's a major way for this state can save $12 billion. And so I think that's something that it's time to get more serious on. And so I take your point that we need to prioritize SHINE, and so I've certainly worked to make sure that we do.
I just want to say, when it comes to this issue, it's somewhere, believe it or not, that Adam and I have actually agreed on through all the forums. We both believe that there should be a single-payer option. Only difference is I would like to add a public option on if you did choose to get private insurance. I've worked in countries like the UK, my husband was Scottish, and you know, UAE, and they had national health care and people were there. I think we have to make sure the funding is there, especially with our aging populations. We do get different health needs, and every human being is entitled to health care, point blank.
Diane, question for Chris, please.
Okay. Do you favor a ballot question for legalizing marijuana for adults' recreational use? And if that ballot is approved, what additional provisions would you like to see the legislature enact to address public safety concerns or enforcement of minimum age and quantity limits?
Okay, I think I shocked Dalton last time I answered this because I said long live Cheech and Chong. And what I mean by this is I do think there are some things we have to look at. And Andrea Harrington had pointed out a very good one. It's about OUI and people driving and how the cops can't tell if you're under the influence. And we need to have some kind of test so that people are safe on the roads. And as we know, the human brain in the 20s is just fully developing. And so we have to also make sure we're protecting our young. However, I was reading statistics on this, and the biggest users are actually ages 45 to 47 and up. Kids are now using synthetic drugs. Marijuana really isn't their choice. The only good thing I think coming from this, it will pave the way for pharmaceuticals and for our areas to gain economic growth from it. Like I said, for the plastics, the beauty industry, and hemp growing this stuff. Personally, I've never used it, so I can't tell you firsthand what I think would happen. However, I talked to some restaurant owners and they feel that their business would go up. And I'll end it there.
Yeah, this has been a tough one for me because philosophically I have no problem with sensible adult use of cannabis. And you know, I think there's room for a step forward in the Commonwealth. The problem that I've been kind of wrapping my head around is what do we do to protect the developing brain? And so in my work in Northern Berkshire County, we've been grappling with this quite a bit. And what does it mean that, you know, the brain is still developing until 24 or 25 and the impact of substance use during that period? And so that's where I've been hesitating on this one. That's why I will vote no. It's why, though, I will be working in the legislature to, if it is passed, to make sure it's passed fully, and that it's implemented fully. And so I do commit to that for sure. There are a range of issues that we need to prepare for maybe more attention. And one of them, you put your finger on OUI, how are we handling edibles? What are we doing about the fact that you might have money transfers in the context of, you know, something that's legal on the state level but illegal at the federal level? So there's a range of things that the legislature would have to grapple with.
Thank you. Stephanie, for Adam.
So both of you have talked about how you're great, great team players and you're willing to reach across the aisle, but how do you reach across the aisle without compromising too far?
We have some UN executive, former UN executives in the audience, and a lot of folks have said that to me. Okay, that's great, Adam, that you want to bring those negotiation skills to Beacon Hill, but doesn't that mean you're just compromising? And I've said time and again, well, actually, we must have very different views of what it means to be a negotiator, because, you know, the UN, and I won't belabor this point too much, but, you know, as the custodian of international law, you have a very strong starting point of what's right and what's wrong, whether it's human rights violations or humanitarian law down the line. And in that context, you then sit at the table and make sure that you're meeting basic interests. In my experience, it's been that, you know, it gives you the skills, and negotiation background gives you the skills to actually have the conversation and frame an issue so that you're able to reach across the aisle and say, look, I understand here are the interests for your district or for your perspective on this, and here's where we're coming from. And you can lay out a framework that actually achieves both. And so, and to me, and I just alluded to one where, you know, a major paper manufacturer in Berkshire County said, okay, great, I'm with you on accelerating the transition to green energy, but until we get there, you're talking about elevating costs if we're relying on wind and solar in the short term, and so, you know, what are you gonna do for us there? And so I thought it was brilliant. Okay, let's look at the German model, I believe it's German, of a carve-out for certain industries. And so that's the kind of the conversation, the teamwork that actually would get you from A to B, and that's how I plan to do it.
Well, I've learned life is always give and take. It's never one-sided. And with that, I think I would start with the law, and that's what I usually do, what's on paper. Then I look for the loopholes. And I couch and frame any negotiation I go into looking with a backward design. What do I want as my end product, and how am I going to have to negotiate to get it? For example, a few years ago, I was called down to Paraguay because the teachers and some of the bus drivers were crucifying themselves to crosses in protest. So we had a look at what they were going for, and through open discussions where no judgments were made, just things were put on the table, we learned that there were some teachers working 12 jobs but not being paid because there's a system where you pay the guy who got you the job so that someday maybe you could have it. And I think when you find out these things, that's how you start to make real decisions. It's by listening and then doing, not acting impulsively.
Thank you. Jean, a question for Chris, please.
On the subject of senior housing, how about a real estate tax break for seniors that would certainly help a percentage of seniors to stay in their own home longer? Many states have tax freeze or reductions.
Actually, my town does this. I live in Lanesboro, and we do a tax reduction for seniors. And the way it works is they do volunteer hours, maybe in town hall, and they get a housing break. So this is something that is a big help. But I do think we have to look at giving people breaks. The loophole and problem we're going to run into are other people saying, well, I have this problem, I have that problem, I should qualify. And so it becomes an equity issue. So I think they have to look at other ways to help seniors be able to say, these are the laws and this is who it pertains to. So as a legislator, I'd make sure it was very clear who was truly eligible and who wasn't. Because otherwise you could have people saying, I'm gonna have my mother say she owns my house so I don't have to pay taxes. You know, and you see that a lot when you get into people who are trying to save and they put their house in trust for children. And technically they're supposed to pay their children a check every month for 5 years to save that money off the taxes, and they don't, and then they go to sell the houses and this becomes an issue. You know, so I think we have to really make sure the laws are clear and people understand them with comprehensible, friendly language, not at things that have embedded clauses subject to appropriation.
Yeah, the starting point is we shouldn't be balancing our budgets on the backs of our seniors, right? And so that's to kind of think that we're forcing taxes in those circumstances is deserves pause. I do like this idea. I've also heard of various circuit breaker tax incentives or breaks and the like, payment in lieu of taxes, another great opportunity and a great option. And so this is a great point. I'm glad it was raised.
Okay, Adam, what in your resume is most relevant to this state post? What gets you, what sets you apart from your opponent?
Unfortunately, I've already been dwelling on it numerous times, but literally my entire career has been characterized by getting large groups of people together to get things done. And so, and doing it in an effective way, and doing it in a way that's in line with your highest ideals and your basic values. And so being able to navigate that in the district, and so I think that's one piece of it, is what are you doing here to ensure that, you know, when it comes to either shared services at the town level, in Berkshire County, there's a big conversation emerging now related to school districts. And is there a need to rethink the school districts, i.e. shared services, or even further towards consolidation? And so there are a number of big questions, big conversations, community level kind of conversations that need to take place. I think that absent regional county government and kind of a larger venue for having these conversations, the state senator can play a function in convening and facilitating, particularly over in the Berkshire side, because we don't have a council of government. And so that's one side. And then when it comes to on Beacon Hill, it's the same set of challenges. Is good legislators, you know, you're not a mayor, you're not a governor, you're not an executive, you're a legislator working with others and working with the leadership, and being able to navigate that so that you're a strong voice for us out here is as big as anything. You know, a lot of folks said, that's great that you've been working in Baghdad, but why is that relevant? My first answer is, it meant standing up to some pretty tough actors and not backing down, and it meant taking on the biggest challenges, some of the, you know, that folks call the intractable challenges in the globe right now. And so I think going out that day in and day out is something that means that you're willing to roll up your sleeves and dive into the biggest problems that we have right here.
Thank you, Chris.
I have to agree. We need to write a book on the characters of the Middle East. But here's what I think is important. From working in the Middle East, and because I didn't get to be on American compounds or protected by the military, I know a lot about public safety from teaching INL, from working with KGB and other groups. I think I'm also a real person. And when I mean real, I mean I'm able to reach out to all people. And with my business and my education background, I understand contracts and procurements. I know how to research data, and I follow through with things. And I think that's why I get rewarded time and time again with other contracts. I'm just good at whatever I put myself at, because I'm 110%er.
Thank you. So this will be our last set of questions from. It's turned out to be an excellent panel. And thank you. So we have Kathy, a question for Chris.
Actually, my questions have been answered, so I'd like to defer and hope there's time for more audience questions.
Diane?
Are there more audience questions?
Oh, yes, thank
you. Okay. I'm going to defer to things. You've answered things that I haven't asked, but I don't want to make you repeat them.
Stephanie?
So this is for Chris?
This is for Chris.
Do you see the $15 minimum wage as a positive step for Massachusetts, and would you vote for it in the Senate?
Chris.
The other Chris.
It's interesting, because Adam and I, of the four of us when we first started out, were the two that actually agree on this. So I think it's going to be best, and I don't know if you want to rebut, but we both agree that we should work towards the $15 minimum wage, but the both of us said with exception, and for basically the same reasons. Because a 16-year-old could drop out of school and make $32.5 a year. So we want to make sure that there's some implementation so that kids aren't dropping out. We also have to look at how it affects inflation and how would it affect small business owners and what it would cost in upmarketing things. But we have to make sure people have livable wages, and we have to be fair to all. And so, to be fair with you, we've been at the same thing, and I think we've answered pretty much the same on that, unless it changed, I don't know. Similar, yeah, we both agree on this one.
Right, so I do support a $15 minimum wage. You've heard me talk about some of the reasons why in the previous question, where essentially the minimum wage right now is a poverty wage, and we need a living wage. And so how we get there is, I guess, the important question. That's what Chris is alluding to. Is it incremental in how we get there so that we're protecting certain small businesses and the like? But the bottom line is that is certainly the goal. We've just seen wage stagnation for decades, and it's time for a change that we're focusing on folks who are really trying to make ends meet in our working families.
Thank you. Jean, audience question.
I think you've covered most of these, but let's go for this one.
By 2025, the number of seniors with dementia and Alzheimer's will increase by 25%. I don't know if that's true or not, but most nursing health care is paid by state Medicaid. How will you work to provide adequate care and funding?
This is a big one because, a couple of reasons. I mean, I've had grandparents who are experiencing dementia, and so you're right that when you see firsthand the type of care that requires, really around the clock. I mean, we have countless memories of what happens when you're not there, when somebody isn't there. If you just, God forbid, you go away for the day or go out to friend's place for dinner, and so home care is critical. There's two things. You know, I mentioned earlier that we're going to see growth in the economy related to home care attendants and folks who are assisting seniors and providing health care at home. And yet, quite frankly, they're often at the bottom of the pay scale. And so, apropos to the conversation around minimum wage, is what are we going to do to make sure that that's not the case? It's important for the quality of care, it's important for the income levels of folks in this area in particular. And so in the past weeks, I've been increasingly trying to think that through, and it is an issue. I don't have an answer tonight, but it's one that is important to look at for a whole range of reasons. You know, quality of care, our local economy, training and preparedness, and down the line. And so, great question.
I would agree with Adam on this one too. The amount of people that I know and their parents now are getting dementia and Alzheimer's and being put in special units. One thing I really loved that I saw recently was they've started to make communities where you think that you're inside a garden and you can walk out your door, but you're still enclosed so that you can still have the quality of life. But I'd like to add an extra component on. Beyond what we give for care, and we do need to look at healthcare workers and how they're paid in their treatment, we need to also look at getting educational components to support the families of people, because the stress level and what happens to their kids and their grandkids can sometimes be overwhelming. And it's all about the quality of your life.
Thank you. Jean, question for Chris.
The district you are running to fill is one of the largest in the state, Berkshire County being the largest part of the district. What would you propose to do to better represent those of us in the eastern part of the district than we have, that has been in the past?
I think, well, first of all, I always stand for equity. And I think you should have equal time. Your constituents count as much as any Berkshire County constituent. And I think that means making a day where people know that we're available just for them. Being visible is a big thing. And I also think reading your town reports, reading your warrants, understanding what you need. Because for whatever anyone needs, let's say in New Ashford, they may need in Ashfield. I think there are universal things, and I think also by working together with the other counties, we can look at consolidating prices and consolidating services so that we get the best cost off contracts that go out with the state because they get the lowest prices. I also think in general that I would come out here and I would come and I would talk with people. I mean, really for me, it was just a 45-minute drive into the Berkshires. What's 45 minutes? You know, we do that down the lead. It's not a big deal, but I would represent everybody because I always have and I always will.
I suppose the biggest asset is the fact that I grew up 5 miles away and my parents are still in the same house that I grew up in, and I'm still a part of this community, literally Ashfield and surrounding towns. And so when you're looking for a state senator that actually understands the area and gets it, all I have to do is go so far as to contemplate what I'm experiencing right now, and be it with interactions with the majority of the audience, because I know most of you, or in working through the various, you know, elected officials here, because we're having dinner every other week and not likewise. And so that's one thing that you get from me is somebody who truly gets the region. What would we be doing? I mentioned one earlier is making sure we have a day of the week. I've already had someone offer in Sheldon Falls to have an office out here. I think it's a great idea. Makes sure that me or my staff would be entirely accessible, and that would be a priority for sure.
Thank you, Anne. Jean, our last question of the evening, audience question, for Anne.
Ask your opponent your most important question you want to have answered.
Yes, it's my natural hair color.
Do you support Donald Trump?
You know what? Yes and no. Could I have just gone up and gone to him the other night? Yes. I think the way he spoke to Hillary and the way he has spoken about women has been deplorable. I do not agree with him on those parts. I do agree with him on the financial aspects, but I do not agree with his discrimination. I think he has also belittled women. And for those reasons, I do not support him. What he has said about what needs to be done financially, also some of the securing of our borders, I do agree with him. Do I support Hillary? There are things I agree with her, and there are other times I think, young lady, you need to be investigated a little bit further. So right now, Jill Stein's looking good until I just saw the Facebook video of her spray painting a bus in protest. That's not good behavior either. And so I question you this. In a country as great as ours, how did we end up with those guys running? And that's the bottom line. So I think that's where I stand right now. It's kind of funny. People said to me, do you think you are like Trump? I said, we both have blonde hair. And then when I realized, I dyed it back brown again. So, all right, so my question for you, Adam.
His natural hair color.
Yeah. Adam, what do you like about me?
It's easy. Look, you're vibrant and energetic and hilarious.
You know, I know what people say about candidates, but to be honest with you, we like joke or jab at one another, but over the summer, I think we've gotten to like each other. So this is good.
Well,
what a wonderful evening
from my perch. Actually, I do have one more question for Adam. I'm sorry, Chris, it's for Adam. Now, could you come up here for a second? This is from my perspective.
No.
Could you raise your pant legs, please?
No.
Are those a pair of socks?
You know what? Can I just defend Adam's socks? As a person who does my children's laundry, we all put our socks in the washer and dryer, and only one of each ever comes out. I don't know who needs the socks. So he's justified.
I know that. By way of admission, I've gone with one sock on to work. But before I'm going to ask each of you to do closing comments, but first, Ashfield Council on Aging, thank you so much for putting this together. It was a wonderful evening. The Senior Center, the Reporter, the Northampton Area League of Women Voters, you guys are terrific. Thank you so much. Laura and Kim. Thank you very much. Chris Florey did a great job at bringing us those questions. And of course, our panel here was incredible. Diane and Kathy and Stephanie and Jean and Marky, thank you. Please. So, since Adam started with the opening statement, how about if we have Christine start with the opening, closing statement?
Can we have 2 minutes?
You take your time.
I'll keep this quickly because I see some of you falling asleep out there. I would like to say, if you elect me senator, I will represent you. I'm excellent at business. I will really make sure that we increase our economy. I hope you go to my website, chriscanningforsenate.com, where you can read the 15 points yourself. And I'm excellent at education, and I really want to make sure that your taxes go down and we streamline these budgets. And I'm hoping that we can together work together, and easily and effortlessly you can make that happen. Go behind the booth, close the curtain, and check Chris Canning for State Senate. Thank you.
Well, thanks a lot. I can't, first of all, I appreciate that you thanked everybody so extensively because I wanted to do the same. And so it really has been a pleasure to be a part of this, so thanks a lot. And I can't tell you how much of an honor it is to be sitting here in the Ashfield Town Hall, you know, the town that I grew up next to and has been a part of my life. And to come back and be running to represent all of you is truly an honor. And it's also somewhat daunting. It makes you want to work harder than ever before to make sure that some of these fundamentals that we've been talking about are taken care of. It's just not right that our schools are treated differently when it comes to our funding. It's not right that we're ignored when it comes to things like broadband. It's not right that, you know, when we are dealing with our small towns and struggling just to make ends meet and deciding whether we're going to go without a police car or paved roads and repaired bridges, something isn't right. And so that's what's inspired me to get in the race. And in talking with so many of you, there's a range of other issues where the Commonwealth has been leading forward in the country. And we've seen it in expanding healthcare and marriage equality. And we've made some progress even this year on things like pay equity. And we should be proud of that. But there's still so much more we need to be doing. Paid family leave is another one. And how we're gonna accelerate the transition to green energy. And how we're gonna take care of our businesses along the way and making sure that energy costs are reasonable for businesses and homes. And so taking on those big challenges is what's gotten me in the race. And I really look forward to drawing on that background that we've talked about a little bit tonight and dealing with some pretty tough actors to making sure that we have a strong voice here in Western Mass. And so that we have a senator who has the skills and the experience to push an agenda that we need out here, and so that we can be proud of it and do it in a way that is demonstrating that politics can be done differently. I didn't get in this to do it the way we've seen it, and the way we're all shake our head and get frustrated with. I think we can be inclusive and understanding and effective in how we do our politics here. Thank you. So,
just a couple more acknowledgments. First of all, your questions were really incredible. I learned a lot thanks to your questions. I thought that they were intelligent and poignant and gave me the opportunity to hear people who want to represent me as well. So I want to applaud you. Thank you for those questions. And finally, I agree with Chris. This is a great model of how we want candidates to respond and to come here and be accessible and be responsive to very good questions from a really bright panel. So I want to thank you, Chris. I want to thank you, Adam. Thank you all for coming. The candidates will be here if you want to say hello.